Good evening and welcome to the Westmont Downtown Lecture Series, Conversations About Things That Matter. My name is Susan Jackson, and I'm a member of the Westmont Foundation Board. The Westmont Foundation Board sponsors the Westmont Downtown Lecture Series, which began 12 years ago. This series highlights important topics of the day, and the most amazing Westmont faculty bring that information to you. This series is a gift to our community, and the goal is for those who attend to enjoy meaningful and lively conversations. So please don't be shy to ask questions of our fine speakers. Another announcement we have tonight is the Westmont President Breakfast is featuring General Stan McChrystal. That's Friday, March 3rd, from 7 to 9 a.m. And you can buy tickets on the Westmont website. Our next Westmont Downtown Lecture will be Thursday, April 13th, from 5:30 here at the club. Donald Patterson, Professor of Computer Science, will speak on the subject, Should We Hide from Big Data? Now I take great pleasure in introducing to you Dr. Mark Sargent. He will then introduce our speakers. Dr. Sargent assumed the role of provost at Westmont College in the spring of 2012. A graduate of UCSB, he earned his master's degree and doctorate degree in English at the Claremont Graduate University, specializing in American literature. He has a long and distinguished career in higher education. He joined Westmont after 16 years as provost of Gordon College in Massachusetts. Westmont was not new to Dr. Sargent, for his wife, one of his sons, and his daughter all graduated from Westmont. And I welcome Dr. Sargent.
Thank you very much, Susan. And thanks to all of you for coming. This is a wonderful, wonderful turnout. Thanks for being here for this evening. This is a very special event for me to hear from this group of faculty colleagues, because the experience that they're going to describe is an experience that I was able to share a part of, an immersion experience that we had at the border. All of you know, you don't need me to tell you, that conversations about the border, about immigration, are significant controversies at this time. And I'm often told when we do complicated and controversial topics, make sure that your presentation focuses on both sides. Well, this is a topic that doesn't have two sides. This is really a topic that has thousands and thousands of faces, individual lives that are significantly affected by these issues, whether they are migrant workers, or whether they are patrol agents, or whether they are leaders of various humanitarian groups, Christian ministries, doctors. There are many, many individuals that are involved in what takes place at our border. And part of the purpose of our experience together was to see more and more of the complexity and the human faces involved in this struggle. And this is a really wonderful group of faculty who are thoughtful, deeply caring about the work that they do with students, and deeply caring about justice and mercy in our world. And so it's a pleasure for me to introduce them. My far right is Chris Hoeckley. Chris is the director of the Gaede Institute for the Liberal Arts at Westmont College. He also teaches in the philosophy department. And next to him is Cheri Larson Hoeckley. Cheri is the chair of our English department and is the sort of founder, one of the founders and leaders of our gender studies program at Westmont. Chris and Cheri, they're married, and they are also the co-directors of the Westmont and Northern Europe program. They led many off-campus study programs for Westmont, and the last several years have led a program that focuses on peace and reconciliation topics in Northern Europe, particularly Northern Ireland and Berlin. Next to them is Liz Robertson, who is the director of Emerson Hall, a resident director on campus, works a lot and does many things within our student life program. Liz is fluent in Spanish, which was helpful on our trip, as well as someone who just has a wonderful reputation on our campus for being present in the moment with students, helping students in their moment of concern or crisis, but helping students get firm sense of vision for what they might do with their future. So we're glad to have her with this group. And then finally, on my immediate right is Cynthia Toms, who is an associate professor of kinesiology and global studies at Westmont. She directs our global studies program. She served the last 3 years as director of global education at Westmont. She was the person who really had the vision for this program, for this immersion experience, and was the main coordinator of it. She brings a vast amount of experience working internationally to Westmont, including time teaching overseas in China and directing and being assistant director of a program in Uganda. So it's a pleasure for me at this time to have Cynthia come and frame the experience, and then we'll hear from all of our speakers. So please welcome Cynthia and the whole group. Thanks.
Thanks for such a nice introduction, Dr. Sargent. Thanks everyone for being here tonight. It's wonderful to see so many people interested in such an important topic. So my role tonight is I'm going to just spend a few minutes framing our time together, and I'm going to try to just simply answer three questions before I then turn it over to my colleagues. I want to just address why the border, why are we talking about it in this kind of very personal way, and why Tucson in particular? So why the border? In our day and age, especially today, we probably don't need more rhetoric and dialogue, right? For many of us, it's kind of a barrage of the senses recently. Discussions, news headlines, even for many of us, recent and hard discussions with friends. So many meanings and constructs by many voices and ideas, but rarely the voices of the people who are directly affected by those issues. People whose lives are oftentimes altered, displaced, even in some cases lost, because of this issue that we simply call immigration or migration. But what we're really talking about is a border, a boundary, a line that denotes great significance, and at times creates categories just by its mere existence. Yes, we know globalization connects our lives intricately across these borders, and goods, sometimes more often than people, can find free-flowing movement between nations, and oftentimes it feels continuous in that way. But for people, and the movement of certain people, borders inhabit more than just physical and geographic dimensions. They present us with spatial boundaries, and they can be significantly different. They can feel foreign, they can feel relatively local to us, depending on how we see things. So it's a political, cultural, racial, economic issue. But for many of us, the border, above all, is also a theological issue. And closer examination reveals to us that we as a global church have brothers and sisters of faith living just over the border. The one image that I have coming up here is one of the Bibles that was found by one of the folks that we got to hear from right alongside this border, demonstrating very similar beliefs with our brothers and sisters that are caught in this issue. So as Christians, we can't avoid an examination of the characteristics that are beginning to define our modern age today. And what does it require of us? It entails an openness, a willingness to listen. Reading the signs of the times is something that people of faith have done for centuries in order to enact an appropriate response. One of the things that we did as a group before we went down is we read some significant documents, theology around these issues. And one of the quotes that really stuck out to me was an author that said, "As far as borders separate us from them, they become barriers to the God who revealed himself first among the strangers and the aliens." Not coincidentally, the most vibrant, thriving Christian churches in our globalized world are to be found not among civilized people, but oftentimes among those on the outside. For it is there that our idolatry is unmasked and we see the crucified and risen Christ best revealed. So borders represent a lot of things, even in our own lives, even in our own faith. But this is one thing that we've discovered that we hope to convey to you tonight, that borders can be transformative. They were for us. If you're willing to move past the politics and at times the fatiguing rhetoric, and look to the people in the stories, I think you'll find the same beauty that we did. And so why personal? Well, the purpose of our seminar was to intentionally try to move past that rhetoric and choose a paradigm that would represent faces and hear stories of people directly caught in this issue that we call immigration. And so again, the experiences that we share with you today were, yes, so that we could learn as a faculty, but it was much more than that. It was to move beyond politics to this personal understanding, from rhetoric to real stories. And we could have chosen to remain within our disciplines, to examine NAFTA and its impact on trade. We could have talked about the history of labor laws in our country. We could have spent time exploring immigration reform, because maybe that would have been a little bit more comfortable for us. But instead, our faculty and staff got up very early in the morning and boarded a bus and took a flight down and spent quite a bit of time in a listening capacity to people, quite a bit of time gathered around hearing the stories. Because while it's true that migrants face a harrowing journey, there are a lot of voices to be heard at the border. Those of farmers living in the region, of law enforcement officers who daily interact with both migrants as well as trying to enforce our civil policies. There are churches. Churches at the border who do not have the luxury and to have the proximity of cushion and distance in their response. They have to respond literally to the person just outside their door. And even the traditional government systems that are forced to become forensic experts for the many people who have lost their lives and to determine the next steps for families that are caught between those borders. So that's why we wanted this to be a personal journey. I want to say a word about Tucson as a particular border, because we're very close to San Diego. And at the time that we went, it was hot and dry enough in Santa Barbara, unlike these last couple of days. So why go all the way there? I have been a part of other border immersions in the El Paso, Juarez, as well as San Diego. And the reality is that Tijuana, Mexico, crossing that border, it's closer to us, but there are reasons that we choose to go to Tucson. The border agencies in Tijuana, if we were to go down and talk with them, and I've heard them describe just an incredible decrease in apprehensions and arrests, which is true at that crossing site. But the reality is that they've come with the improvement and the expansion of a wall that traces back to a 1994 decision to secure the California border and close off migration routes through that urban site. It shifted that pattern into the remote desert area of Arizona that you'll see in our pictures today. Instead of stopping the flow of people attempting to cross the border, there was an effective shift of channeling them to a place where instead of a wall that they would face, they would be challenged with a desert, a challenge of epic proportions that takes more than a week to cross through desert-like conditions, temperatures reaching well over 120 degrees in the day, dipping into freezing at night, where water is too heavy to carry an ample amount for more than a day or two, where there are thieves and snakes and animals along the road. And as a result, the number of border deaths doubled from 1995 to 2005. Although apprehensions went down, deaths went up. And with nearly 500 dying in 2010, and the high heat index, people continue to cross. Why is there no slowing of that traffic? Well, that's a complex answer. And as you'll hear from the stories from Liz and from Chris and from Cheri today, the answers are not always clear, and we learned that from the people that we met. It's sometimes as simple as a human push for survival when there's no other options. Sometimes it's a much deeper layered story of love between parents and children and families, even hopes for the future, the kind of good life that many of us want. And so I'm going to turn it over to my colleagues to share a bit about some of the stories that they heard that represented all of those things. So Liz Robertson is going to start us off.
Our border immersion experience was bookended by two different walks in the desert. As I share about each walk, you will see pictures of both the beauty and the desolation of the Sonora Desert. It is breathtaking and it is harsh. It is full of life and yet isolated. We spent our first day in the desert with Bob Key, who volunteers with Samaritans. Samaritans is a nonprofit organization whose mission is to save lives in the southern Arizona desert. Samaritans' premise is that it's never illegal to provide humanitarian aid, which would be giving food, water, or providing medical care to another human being who's in distress. Believe it or not, and this shows my own selfishness, prior to our trip, the part of the trip I was the most nervous about was spending an entire day walking in the desert. Now, I'm in reasonably good shape. I actually enjoy hiking, but when it's really hot outside, like 90 or 100 degrees, I just start to feel really sick in the heat. So I knew the desert would have high temperatures and scorching sun. I also take hydration very seriously, and I wasn't sure if I would be able to carry enough water for myself for the day. Water weighs about 8 pounds a gallon, making it difficult to transport when traveling on foot. I had an expectation of spending our day walking on a well-established trail through the desert, carrying water and food packs to migrants, and generally feeling good about myself and how I was spending my day. I had even brought some of my nicest athletic gear, comfortable shoes, and I filled my North Face backpack with my water, my lunch, and Clif bars. Like, I was ready for a day of hiking. But my expectations were quickly shattered when we arrived at Southside Presbyterian Church and met Bob Key, who works with Samaritans. And he informed us that he had received a report about a missing 15-year-old boy. He asked if we would be willing to spend our day searching for the missing teenager, rather than sticking with our original plan of just walking through the desert and providing water. All of a sudden, what it truly meant to be a migrant in the desert was before us, and the extent of my own selfishness was apparent to me. It put a serious focus on our day and covered us with a deep sense of mindfulness. Instead of walking on a trail, we were bushwhacking in the middle of a harsh desert, searching for a missing 15-year-old. The seriousness of the situation in which we found ourselves, coupled with the fear of what we might find, was ever present. The best case scenario, we find a teenager who's in need of significant medical help. In the worst case scenario, we find human remains. It was a time of silence, solitude, and reflection for each of us, which provided a very necessary preparation for what the rest of the week would hold. There was a heightened awareness that for many migrants coming to the United States, going through the desert is their only option. And as we walked, we discovered extensive evidence of those whose feet had tread the path before us. Water bottles, cans, shoes, backpacks, clothes, tiny children's shoes. After several hours of walking, I became intensely aware of the impossibility of surviving a 5 to 7 day walk in the desert without any water. That's the average length of time it takes to walk from Nogales, Mexico to Tucson, Arizona. All of a sudden, immigration went from being a policy buzzword to something deeply personal. I realized that no one would choose to walk through the desert unless he or she was truly desperate. No one would choose to go through that unless he or she was determined to seek out a better life for themselves and their family. And yet amidst the seriousness and sadness of the situation, I found hope from Isaiah 43, 18 through 19. Forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up, do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the desert. On our last day in Arizona, we had our final walk at Lori's house. Lori lives in the Green Valley, which is a rural area about halfway between Nogales, Mexico and Tucson, Arizona. She is personally committed to providing humanitarian aid to migrants. Over the years, she has found several sets of human remains on her own property. We walked together around her property, and she led us to the various locations where human remains had been found. It was a quiet and very consecrated space. Each location was marked with a cross. For some, you could look right over your shoulder and see neighboring houses, cementing the truth that migrants were so close to help as they took their final breath. Lori invited us into her practice of reading a poem or a song at each cross, and we joined her in the sacred journey of reflecting on the individual life represented by each cross, knowing each migrant had a story, a family, hopes, and dreams of a better future. Each cross was marked with a Spanish word, desconocido, which means unknown. After reading a poem, Lori would yell out, desconocido, meaning unknown, and we would all yell back in Spanish, presente, which means present, which means your spirit was present there. We honored the concept of the individual person being unknown to us, but recognizing that his or her spirit was present in that place when they took their final breath. One cross in particular was marked desconocido adolescente, which means unknown teenager. I was reminded of a quote I heard in a movie that captures the significance of giving dignity to each individual life through this process, and therefore each individual death. Your death will not go unnoticed because I will notice it. Your death will not go unwitnessed because I will be your witness.
Thank you, Liz. Liz's comments are just bringing back for me what an emotionally powerful experience this was for us. If you can believe it, the most moving experience for me was at the federal courthouse in Tucson. And I did not expect this. I expected this visit to the federal courthouse to be the most bureaucratic experience of our time there. But it was pretty moving for me, as it turned out. We observed the courtroom proceedings of a federal program known as Operation Streamline. It's a program that is meant to deter undocumented border crossing by convicting border crossers with a crime and seeing that they serve time in detention, as opposed to simply apprehending and deporting undocumented immigrants, which was the practice for many years and remains the practice on some sectors of the border. The effect of this so-called zero tolerance policy, in which every apprehended border crosser is charged with a crime, has been to pour tens of thousands of defendants into the federal judicial system. The caseloads of the federal courts in the Southwest have grown massive. What we witnessed in court is a part of the government's solution to these massive caseloads. We came in and were seated in the gallery, and I'm sorry I don't have images of this, you can't take a camera in with you. We came in and were seated in the gallery. In front of us was a block of, I think, 55 men seated with their backs to us, separated by a few feet, and just in front of us were five women. Off to the side, there were maybe 10 public defenders. Nearby was the prosecutor. Stationed throughout the courtroom were several U.S. marshals. And at the front of the courtroom facing us sat the judge, to his left a clerk, and to his right a translator. May I play a clip for you of what we heard? This recording isn't from our session. Cameras and recording equipment aren't allowed, as I mentioned. But I managed to find this recording on the web. Its sound quality is terrible. I think it was surreptitiously recorded, so forgive me. But I'm quite certain that we're hearing the voice of the judge who presided over the session that we witnessed. So let's see if we can play the sound.
Each of you understand the rights you're giving up, the charges against you, the maximum penalties of those charges, the consequences of pleading guilty, and the terms of your written plea agreement. Mr. Cordero?
Same.
Yes.
Mr. Gregorio?
Same.
Yes.
Mr. Catalan?
Same.
Yes.
Mr. Alvarez?
Same.
Yes.
Mr. Lee?
Same.
Yes.
As to all five defendants, it is the judge or the court that they are found guilty of the petty offense of illegal entry.
So what you just heard was a part of an exchange between the judge and five defendants. The exchange would have lasted in total about maybe 3 minutes. And here you have an image, a sketch from someone who visited a courtroom. I think the very courtroom we were in. You can see the judge in the very front. The defendants have the headphones in, and their lawyers are standing behind them. The exchange ended with the judge sentencing each defendant to between 30 and 180 days in prison, followed by deportation. Then those five were removed from the court, and the next five would approach the bench, and the same process was repeated. Over the course of maybe an hour or so, roughly 60 defendants had been found guilty of the petty offense of illegal entry and sentenced to detention, followed by deportation. I must say that after several repetitions of the exact same exchange, with different names, of course, but other than that, the exact same exchange, it began to sound like a litany, like the communion service at my church, or your church, perhaps. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. There are these stock elements, obviously, of our liturgies, and this began to sound like a liturgy, except that the centerpiece of the litany was culpable, guilty, culpable, guilty, culpable, guilty. We spoke with the judge after the proceedings. One of the remarkable things he said was that each defendant would have first met their lawyer, their public defender, that morning, and had only about 20 minutes or so with that lawyer. In that time, the lawyer is supposed to ascertain whether their client is competent to stand trial. They're meant to explain to the defendant the charges he or she faces, to determine whether there is a defensible case, to clarify the options before them to accept a plea agreement or to go to trial, and the consequences of each option, and finally to advise the defendants on how to plead. In fact, about all there's time for is for the lawyer to explain that if they don't plead guilty, they risk a much longer jail time. Almost everyone pleads guilty, which is precisely the point. Trials are slow and costly. With nearly universal guilty pleas, 60 to 70 defendants can be processed in just a couple of hours. Hence the name streamline. But it wasn't the serious concerns about due process, and there are serious concerns about due process, it wasn't those concerns that really shook me up. There were three moments in the court proceedings that ultimately sent me reeling. The first was realizing that the young girls in front of us, and maybe we can switch to the next slide, the young girls in front of us were not part of the audience. They were grown women soon to be convicted and sentenced to prison. The next really shocking moment was when one of the women was called forward. It took me a moment to realize what I was looking at, but it suddenly dawned on me that she was shackled. Why, I thought, was she shackled? And then I realized that everybody was shackled. I couldn't fathom why. And I couldn't bear the inhumanity of it. Sometime well into the proceedings, I realized that I'd been lulled into a daze by the repetition of the same exchange over and over again. I realized that I was participating in the very dehumanization that the whole process encourages. Somehow I awoke from that, and my attention focused on Mr. Contreras. Let's move to the next slide. This is not an image of him, but it just gives you a sense. I have no idea how I even remember his name, but it occurred to me that Mr. Contreras had a story. He had hopes and fears. He had loved ones he was separated from. He was probably humiliated and frustrated, maybe angry, certainly uncomfortable. The migrants who are in this process are in the clothes they were apprehended in and have been for several days. He had the full depth of human experience that I have. And more than that, he is God's beloved just as I am. Obviously, that's an obvious truth. But I needed to, in that moment, be awakened to that obvious fact. And that, in the end, is what broke me. There are a lot of policy discussions of streamline available on the web. and I hope you'll learn more about it. Is it effective? Is it constitutional? How costly is it? I'm trying to learn more myself. But as I do, I hope I don't forget that whatever labels we attach, illegal immigrant, undocumented border crosser, economic migrant, defendant, accused, beneath all of the labels is a person. And whatever policy I support cannot overlook that. Humane policy, I think, is the only supportable policy.
My job batting cleanup is to tell you a couple of stories about some of the people we were able to actually talk to, migrants at the border. But before I do that, I want to thank you all for being here for an important conversation. Chris and I joined this seminar for all the reasons that Cynthia mentioned all of our colleagues did, but we actually had one other reason that I want to take a couple minutes to tell you about. We were in search of a little bit of insight into our own family history. We have two adopted daughters, excuse me, and one of them was born in Guatemala and crossed the border at Tijuana without documentation shortly before her 8th birthday. 7 years later, when their mom died of lung cancer, she and her sister joined our family. Suddenly, we were the parents of an undocumented immigrant. Not a part of my life that I had ever planned. But this beautiful, witty, hardworking, warm-hearted daughter is now, thankfully, a US citizen. That process took us about 13 years. And a lot of deep anxiety about the real possibility that she might be deported for 8 of those years. And a lot of watching our daughter be fingerprinted and cross-examined in court, a lot of waiting to get a court appointment, a lot of having court appointments canceled in an overloaded system, a lot of coming to realize the unavoidable shame that she bore because of public rhetoric about undocumented immigrants. And we had a lot of resources to navigate the system that a lot of people we were seeing there didn't have. At some point in that really desolate process, we started to say to each other pretty regularly, if more US citizens only knew what a mess this system is, or if they could only get a glimpse of what it does to people, we think the system would change. So thank you for being here. I have time only to talk about just a couple of the migrants we met at two different social service centers. The first location was Grupo Beta, and that was a day shelter sponsored by the Mexican government, and the second was San Juan Bosco, a privately run night shelter. On our second full day together, we took a simple walk through a breezeway, and suddenly we were all in Nogales. We went directly to Grupo Beta. Grupo Beta is an organization funded by Mexican officials to support deportees arriving in Nogales and in several other cities around the border. These returned people are vulnerable to drug traffickers in border towns. When US officials drop them off, officers put all the belongings of the people in their van on the curb, and then they let them out onto the sidewalk. Most of those people have no family in Nogales. They may never even have been to Nogales before. Many of their belongings will have been lost in various steps between local law enforcement offices, where they'd first been detained in local jails, and an ICE processing center before they're turned over to Border Patrol agents who drive them back to Mexico. Some of the migrants are injured. Most of them are severely dehydrated. They generally don't have phones that function in Mexico. Their families in the US often haven't heard from them for days, and that silence causes them anxiety. Drug runners are on the lookout to coerce them to carry drugs back across the border, often at threat of death. And many of them have not been in Mexico for years, even decades. Grupo Beta realizes the vulnerability of these people. We can say more in Q&A about the minimal support, but crucial support that they get offered there if you want to, but I want to use this time to tell you about Renee. We have a photo of some of our colleagues with a gentleman like Renee. Unfortunately, I don't have a photo of Renee. Renee was a young man in his early 20s. Sorry. when I walked in to join Liz and our colleagues, they were already talking to him And he seemed a little overwhelmed, so I was hesitant. But one of our other colleagues called me over and said in English, "This is Renee." And I was surprised to have Renee respond to me in completely unmarked English. It turns out he'd joined his parents to come north when he was 6 years old. He had, they'd moved a lot for work, and he hadn't felt very successful in school. But he told us quite proudly that he'd spent the last few years as a framer, a carpenter. And he was learning skills that he knew mattered. And there were skills that he was using to support his US citizen girlfriend and the daughter who was born 3 weeks before we met him. Shortly after she was born, an ICE team showed up on his job site looking for someone else, and he was caught up in the sweep and taken to Nassau County Jail, the Washoe County Jail, I'm sorry, for immigration violations. He hadn't been able to contact his girlfriend or his mother for several days, and he was particularly concerned because his girlfriend needed to cash his last paycheck to cover expenses for the baby, and she couldn't do it without him. He'd had no cash because the money he was carrying when he was picked up was deposited for him by county sheriffs, and he was issued a debit card to retrieve it, but he hadn't been able to make the debit card work outside the US. I later learned that this problem is common. NUME Financial Services works with law enforcement and deportation officials, and deportees frequently find themselves without access to the money they were carrying when they were picked up because they can't activate their debit cards in Mexico. As a Mexican national, Renee could ask Grupo Beta to buy him a bus ticket to the town where his grandmother lived. He knew where that town was because from early childhood, his mother had taught him and his siblings to memorize his grandmother's name and address in case they ever got separated from their parents and were picked up in a sweep, so that they would at least be able to tell people on the other side of the border somewhere they could go. But he didn't remember his grandmother personally. He did seem to hope, though, that she was his best hope for eventually reuniting with his girlfriend and raising their child. If he crossed again and he was caught, he'd be blocked from reentry for 10 years. He was distraught, and he was extremely polite. 3 weeks ago, he'd been working to support a new family, and when we met, his money was gone, and his best option seemed a wild goose chase to a town he didn't remember, to find a grandmother he wasn't sure he would recognize, and then to wait for his US citizen family. That evening, we went to San Juan Bosco, a shelter run by Don Francisco, who you see there with our interpreter, Scott. San Juan Bosco provides beds and an evening meal for a small number of migrants in Nogales every night. And those services are entirely funded by Don Francisco and his wife, Hilda, because they felt like they had to respond to what they were seeing in migrants being dropped across the border. In the past 34 years, they've served more than 1 million people in Nogales. We arrived just before dinner, and we were taken to a sitting room where we were able to ask a small group of migrants if we could talk to them. So we broke up into small groups, and I was one of three who began to talk to two young men who turned out to be 17 and 18. The older one was from Chiapas, that's in southern Mexico, and the younger one had come from Guatemala. They'd been just dropped off in Nogales by Border Patrol that day. They were both going north separately. They'd met coming back in a detainee van, and they were hoping to find work. The Guatemalan had a family friend in LA he had hoped to connect with, and the young man from Chiapas had a brother in New York, but he hadn't really thought he was ever going to make it that far north. He just hoped to make it across the border. Both of them had paid traffickers, and both of them had planned to work for a year or two and go home and start a life with the money they saved. They were clearly exhausted, frightened, and confused. So shortly into the conversation, the three of us just started talking to them about anything we could think of to change the subject. We talked about their siblings, our dogs, we had photos out on our phone showing them our pets. And at some point, we kind of lapsed into mom talk, a couple of us who were there. I wanted to know when the last time was they'd had a drink of water or what they had eaten that day. The answer was, I don't remember, and nothing. They did warm up a little bit, though, and we got a glimpse of how much they were just kids who had taken on a very treacherous journey because there was no way for them to work in the towns they called home. Shortly before we got up to leave, I asked them what they would like us to tell Americans about them, and they both got very quiet. The young man from Guatemala lowered his eyes and then looked in our direction, but didn't directly make eye contact, and said in Spanish, Tell them the Border Patrol doesn't have to be cruel to us. My friends and I ran out of water. We were walking toward them. One of them threw us on the ground and stood on my arm, and they laughed at us. They didn't have to do that to us. As you saw in some of our pictures, we also met Border Patrol agents, and I believe the Border Patrol agents we met when they tell us they see themselves in part as people who are there to protect the migrants from the criminals and the drug runners that are on the borders. I also believe not all of their colleagues, and they gave us some reason to believe that, feel exactly like the agents we met. In conversation about immigration, I repeatedly hear Americans say, but we're a compassionate people, or we're a compassionate nation. I believe that deeply. I also know that too few of us know what our policies end up meaning in practice, or what the fine print leads to in many of the ways that people's lives are shaped and broken in places like Nogales. So I want to thank you all for taking a little bit of time to listen this evening.
As you can see from the stories, many people along the border don't necessarily seem to agree on their differences or solutions. But they do agree on one thing, and that is that U.S. immigration policy is broken and in need of change. There may not be some consensus over whether the borders need to be opened or closed, or whether undocumented immigrants should be offered a path to citizenship or how migrant workers affect the economy, but from the faith perspective and from our time there, we recognize that human hardship and the death toll and the current stalemate has created a humanitarian crisis, and that's the word that we heard over and over from multiple groups. Tragically, we live in a divided world, in a society, and one of the things that we felt privileged to do was to go to people who were most affected by the issue. Getting knowledge from people that suffer the consequences can tell the story of reality in a way that those of us that don't feel it in the same way can't. And one of the things that I will not forget is a woman who told us to go and tell her story and to tell it well. And we feel responsible for that. So I hope that that came across tonight. One of the wonderful things that came out of this was an opportunity for us to continue to pray and to gather as a group and to think about ways to simply just raise awareness of the many faces that you all have seen tonight, the many people that we met. And we continue to do that. We continue to think about ways to educate and to pray and to support. So one of the prayers that came out of that time, Liz is going to read to finish our time, and then we'll have time for question and answer. So Liz, would you mind reading that?
So this is a migrant's prayer. I'm going to read it first in Spanish, and then I will read it in English. Viajar hacia ti, Señor, eso es vivir. Partir es un poco morir. Llegar nunca es llegar definitivo hasta descansar en ti. Tú, Señor, conociste la migrancia y la hiciste presente a todo hombre que comprende qué es vivir y quiere llegar seguro al puerto de la vida. Tú sacaste de su tierra a Abraham, padre de todos los creyentes. Tú recordaste cuáles eran los caminos para llegar a ti por los profetas y los apóstoles. Tú mismo te hiciste migrante del cielo a la tierra. The journey towards you, Lord, is life. To set off is to die a little. To arrive is never to arrive until one is at rest with you. You, Lord, experienced migration. You brought it upon all men who know what it is to live, who seek safe passage to the gates of heaven. You drove Abraham from his land, father of all believers. You shall remember the paths leading to you, the prophets and the apostles. You yourself became a migrant from heaven to earth. Amen.
Well, thank you for this time for formal presentation. Many of you received a resource sheet on your way in. There are a few opportunities to learn more at upcoming events at Westmont. There's an art exhibit. There's also a discussion on a book called Into the Beautiful North that we'll be having shortly on our campus. We also just wanted to provide some books and additional reading if you would like to just simply continue to educate yourself and to be aware. We're going to turn this time over for question and answer, and so we have a microphone. Try, if you can, to speak loudly so everyone can hear you. Yes.
Yeah, I'm going to repeat her question. She asked if we ever found the missing migrant that we were looking for. Oh, this missing teenager. And the answer is we did not find him, but Border Patrol found him later that day, which was actually a huge answer to prayer. When we got done doing our search and we went back to our cars, there were Border Patrol cars all across the road right where we had been. So they were searching in a very similar area and had found him.
Alive?
Alive, yes.
So some of you in the back may not have caught the gentleman's comment that back in the day he learned in history that Abraham Lincoln had once dreamt of I suppose, open borders between Canada, the United States, and Mexico. And of course, we're a long ways from that. It is interesting, actually, that we have made steps toward sort of economic, open economic borders. NAFTA represents that. But we don't have alongside that, obviously, open borders for human movement. And that's an interesting contrast, in my view, to what the European Union has attempted, where they link the open economic borders to the free movement of people. That's an interesting contrast that I want to learn more about and might be worth exploring further.
I'll just say one more word on that, because I think that we'll hear things about the North American Free Trade Agreement in the future. The interesting thing about that is that it was passed in 1996, right around the time that we began to continue to shore up more of our borders with California, as I mentioned earlier. So just pointing to that, we do continue to allow the free trade of goods, but not the free trade, or the free movement of people. But I think it's something that we'll hear more about. So on your resource sheet, The Other Side of Immigration is a movie that's listed there that deals directly with this issue. And it gives the perspective, it's all in Spanish with subtitles, but it gives the perspective of Mexican farmers and families on the other side of the border and how that NAFTA free trade agreement has affected them. So if you're interested in that issue, it's a great free watch on Netflix.
Above and beyond local control. So there was, I heard, one water issue where they were polluting water, the local people organized, they tried to stop something, they could not. So it's a mixed bag.
Just for the sake of those who might. The guest here in front noted that one of the consequences of NAFTA has been that control sometimes of resources leaves the hands of the local community in Mexico and sort of goes into the hands of the international corporations that that set up shop there.
Yes.
You mentioned that defendants are coached to plead guilty. And I'm curious if you're familiar with any cases or examples in which defendants acted otherwise and what the consequences of that might be.
Yes, thank you. So the question was,
of any cases where defendants in Operation Streamline opted to plead not guilty instead of pleading guilty. We didn't hear about that there. As it turns out, roughly 99% of defendants plead guilty. One of the reasons for that is that it's made clear to them that the consequences, the likelihood of winning the case is slim, and the consequences have been made quite severe. So in the proceedings we watched, we were seeing proceedings for those who had recrossed the border, second time border crossers. That, as a part of Operation Streamline, that offense was made a felony. And it carries a minimum sentence of 2 years and a maximum sentence of 20 years. So you can see that the consequences are ratcheted up very high, so that there's strong incentive to plead to a lesser charge. That lesser charge is, as you heard the man say, to the petty offense of illegal entry. And that typically then gets a 1 month to 6 month prison sentence. That's a much lower sentence. So people don't try their cases because the risk is tremendously great, simply because we have opted as a society to make second time crossing such a severe crime.
I just want to add something to that. When we were at Operation Streamline, and correct me if I'm wrong, there was a defendant who asked for amnesty, I believe, like in that was asking for protection from the United States, who feared being persecuted when sent back.
Asylum.
Thank you. And what he was told was, after you have served your prison sentence and you're deported, then you can ask for that. So just, I think, to be mindful of some of the conditions that are happening right now, specifically in Latin America and Guatemala and Honduras, people really are fleeing for their lives. And so to listen to somebody ask for that and then be told, well, after you serve your sentence and are deported, then you can try again.
Yeah. So while we're on, now you said through the proceedings of 60 people in an hour were processed this way?
2 hours.
2 hours? How long, is this like a normal thing? This goes on day after day, hour after hour. So what you're talking about is a machine that just eats people alive, basically, at that point.
It's several times a week. So the federal judges who are in that courthouse, they all kind of have shifts where they do that. So we watched, it was about 60 people processed in 1 hour. But it's like somebody has their, this is my afternoon to do that. So that's happening several times a week in that courthouse, but not all day, every day, if that answers your question.
Yeah, but then they're sentenced to prison at that point.
That's right.
Yes, they are.
So how many a week, do you guess, had to go through this?
I don't know. I'd have to look online, because I'm sure you could find it if you looked for Operation Streamline specifically. Well, it's across the whole southern border, so not just Tucson, including other states as well. Right. So I'd have to look it up. I don't know.
Ministries or efforts to bring safe passage for people returning to, let's say, that young man's grandmother's hometown.
The Mexican government will provide people with bus tickets. So if you're a Mexican national, Grupo Beta would give you a bus ticket to get back, put you on a bus and send you back to wherever your home city was. I'm gonna let somebody else talk about sanctuary because I'm suddenly foggy on details.
I want to make sure I understood your question. Are you asking about faith group responses, churches at the border, or can you?
It could include, yeah, faith group.
for example, sure. If you're not a Mexican national, you're from Honduras, you're from Nicaragua. Yeah.
Sure.
You know, how do you have any chance of safe passage back to your home country? What's provided?
Yes, the short answer is very little. So you're not dropped off with resources. And one of the people that we talked with was brought to a town that he'd never been before, quite far away from where he had lived. And so it's, I'm not sure how to, Grupo Beta has some resources, and I don't believe that they discriminate by nationality. But we didn't necessarily hear of someone who was given the opportunity to travel back to their home. That was not a provision that we heard anyone say was made for them by any group or by any government program.
Because currently the response of the United States is, it doesn't really matter what country you came from in Central America, we're going to put you, dump you over the border into Mexico and you figure it out from there.
And let me just add to that, that one of the tactics that has been employed with the increase of attempted crossings is to take people who are detained trying to cross near San Diego, Tijuana, and taking those people to the border near Tucson so that they have less of an opportunity to gain resources to try to recross. So there's actually a program in place so that people are not brought back to an area where they would have networks and resources, but rather trying to displace them as a tactical way to keep them from trying to cross again.
There is some support in the desert from this organization, Samaritans, who Liz talked about, who we walked out with, but even they are not allowed to transport people.
That's a felony.
So they can give them food, they can give them water, they can provide medical aid, but it's a, and they can't give directions and they can't transport people. Those are criminal activities.
So when we talked with Bob Key, who was our host with Samaritans when we were there, he told us specifically he can ask migrants, do you know where you are? But they can't say, go this direction, this far, go here, because that's considered aiding someone, considered a felony.
We have an image of one of those, I think. Is it? Do we?
Oh, unless we put it back. Hmm.
Now you get to see all the extra beautiful images that we had. Well,
I will find it. You keep talking.
I'm not sure that you need an image, but if we do have one, some of the beautiful stories that we had an opportunity to hear were from faith-based groups that were reaching out and providing provisional needs for people, both spiritually as well as physically, and even at times providing those people a place to stay while they were trying to figure out what would happen to them legally and with their families. And so that was a part of, I think, a privilege we got to hear. And the movement of churches that began doing this in the U.S. actually began at that place. So we had a chance to hear some people that were thought leaders within the faith, the Christian faith culture, that really cared deeply about this and really lived trying to reach out to people who showed up at their doorstep with very little.
And I should also be clear, Don Francisco and his wife Hilda were feeding people at the border and giving 34 of them a night beds, but the needs are overwhelming in most border cities, so they were able to do a tiny bit. And that's not helping people get back, it's just meeting immediate needs of people who have been dropped.
You mentioned that in border control story with those two young boys that they had physically harmed them and had mocked them. I'm wondering, anybody can answer this, did you meet with border control and how did you find their attitude to their job to be?
We did spend a couple of hours at one of the border patrol stations and we met with two or three border patrol agents. Boy, did they have amazing stories. Two of the agents were the children of immigrants, one the child of undocumented immigrants, remarkably. As Cheri said, our impression of really these young people was of caring people. They were quite proud of their weapons. That left me a little uncomfortable. But, you know, they seemed like fine young people. They were also a part of the public affairs
dimension of Border Patrol. So, you know, we were certainly encountering Border Patrol's best and brightest.
The male officer who you see here, they were great. They were wonderful people, and they talked about protecting migrants from drug dealers. That's clearly something that they think is important, that they see as important in their jobs. They were also the three officers we met were the only three Latino staff workers we saw in the building that day.
You know, one of the, if I were to share what was a moving experience for me, it was walking through the Border Patrol agency and seeing all of the deterrence against suicide and depression. It's very clear from their stories that at least the Border Patrol agents that we met, one choosing to share very quietly with two or three of us their own crossing over story. It's very clear that they live in conflict, many of them, trying to enforce policies that they themselves may have strong feelings about or that may impact them personally. But it was on the bathroom stalls, it was all around the doors, deterrence and programs against suicide. I mean, very, very clear images. And that was very moving for us to realize that this issue is not something that's one-sided. It was very clear to see that. So I think that was a very moving thing for me, because you couldn't walk away and villainize people who are really trying to struggle. They themselves need a job. If you know who serves in our military and who serves in our law enforcement, they're oftentimes people that are not necessarily of the highest income level. And so these people said they needed the job, and this was a job that they were able to maintain to keep their families fed.
Patrol protecting economic migrants from those who are running drugs and that type of thing. I think my understanding would be just because they do so much work with confiscating drugs and apprehending those who are crossing the border with drugs, that the more they're able to kind of remove those individuals, they feel that they're making it safer for those who are crossing the border. Do we have one final question? Yes, in the back, I see some.
To cross the desert and go into the borders, they are putting themselves into the deep danger. And my professor told me, but I want to help them, and I think that to solve the immigrants issue, it needs the cooperation of all classes of people. But I don't know what's on my shoulder. I don't know what can I do to help them. And my professor told me the job as a physician is to apply our knowledge to solve the places where the war is in deep hunger. But I don't know what to do. Could you guys tell me, like, as a student, as a, like, college student, or...
Great. Thank you, Kevin. Kevin is a student at Westmont who's an international student from China, correct? Yes, okay. And he was just saying, hey, how can I, as a student, what can I do? How can I help? How can I be a part of the solution? So I have some ideas, but the rest of you may as well. I think one of the big things is to educate yourself beyond just reading what gets posted in somebody's Facebook feed, but actually do some real research and find out what are the laws, what are the policies. I think specifically educating yourself, what are some of the common questions people ask, such as, this is what I hear all the time, why can't they just cross the border legally? And I promise you all, if you do some research and you learn what that process is and how long it takes, and you realize it is actually virtually impossible to legally cross over unless you are incredibly wealthy, there is not a legal option for you to do that. So to start to educate yourselves about some of those things, policies. I also think, Kevin, for you, and in a community like Santa Barbara, we have a lot of Latino brothers and sisters in here, in this area, and there's a lot that we can be doing to support them, to hear their stories, to support their family members who may not be documented. There's organizations in our own community, like Immigrant Hope, that are providing resources and wanting to educate individuals so they know their rights and so that they are aware of what the laws are that apply to them. So those are a few things that come to mind.
There are also, we took a long course on this, and there are a lot of organizations that are helping, like some of these are probably in your attendance.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Kevin, you'd be welcome to see us afterward to continue that. We have time for just one more question, and I'm going to take someone here who hasn't asked a question yet in the...
Yeah, you know, I've done a good job of describing the problem and the issue, but having spent this time and effort, what are the two or three ideas that you would put forward that you would change to improve the situation?
I mean, we all probably have some. Yeah. Who wants to go first? Do you want to go first?
I don't care who goes first. Well, you're going to hand me the mic.
So, oh, go ahead.
I feel like you're about to say something.
One of the things I would change is I would ask every American citizen I knew to commit to learning more about our immigration policies, because I do think that would change the way we actually functioned at the border. I think that's a real change, to be able to respond. I think that the way we talk and think about immigration would change, and that would be a material change in the lives of a lot of people who are living around us. So it's a good question and it's a hard question, but I think there are real changes in people's lives that would matter if all of us knew a little bit more.
Let me take this question next. So let me add to that. There is a very simple, although it's not simple, but a worker visa program has been something we've had in our immigration reform bills. It's something that we've had on the table before the 50s. At times in our country when we've needed labor, we have figured out a way to have worker visa opportunities. That allows family members to not be separated for a long time, to come in for a harvest season, for example, and to cross back over without taking their life in their hands and without having to become a criminal. And the reality is that our economy depends on them. And so one of the things that continues to be on the table, but we have not been able to pass immigration reform, is to allow people the opportunity to cross back and forth legally between our borders and to not make it a choice between criminality and work. So that's one thing I'd say. Secondly, I'd say, going back to something that that Cheri shared earlier, people are treated as criminals and not necessarily left with human dignity. And I think that we can continue to be concerned with security on our borders without stripping people of their human dignity. So I think it's the point of what we were trying to really get across in our seminar and even tonight is the personal, the people, the stories, that this is a human issue. It's not just political. And so if we were to remember that more and to treat people in that way and to not just allow it to be a law, I think it would really revolutionize the way that we as a country, as a world, could relate to each other. So that's the other one.
One concrete change I would make is to end Operation Streamline. The criminalization of border crossing has created a massive burden on our federal agencies. It's extraordinarily expensive. It does not result in less frequent border crossing. It is not acting as a deterrent. And it is threatening the constitutionality of our immigration policies, in addition to the inhumanity. So one concrete appeal that I would make is learn about Operation Streamline and advocate for its ending.
I think we're well over time. Thank you. I'm sorry we don't have time for more comments. We'd love to talk with you afterwards. Thank you so much for engaging this issue.